Okay, so we're back with another Ask GMBN Tech. This is where we answer all your mountain-wide tech-related questions every week. So please continue to fire them in the comments below or the email address on the screen. And we'll kick you off with Pat MAHER. Hi guys, I love those Pacenti bars you had on the show last week. My bike came with Pacenti DL31 rims when it was advertised as having WTB I25s. I can't really find out much about them. There's no reviews on the website or anything. Have you got any clues about them? Have I been ripped off? Well, firstly, no, you haven't. The Pacenti DL35 and 31 rims are really, really good. They are predominantly aimed at enduro. They're quite tough, not necessarily the lightest rim, but that's good because they're durable. Now, the reason you've probably not seen them on the site is either they're an old model or perhaps they're an OEM-specific rim, which means they're designed for bike manufacturers to spec on the bikes rather than the stuff that you would buy aftermarket sales in the shops. Now, something really cool about Pacenti, so the guy behind it, his name's Kirk Pacenti. He's actually the reason that most of us are running 650B wheels, or as you and I probably know it as, 27.5-inch wheels. So 650B, the actual measurement is done in centimetres, and it's a bit of a French sizing. The C refers to the width, the 650 refers to the actual size of the wheel. The actual size is nearer to 27-inch than it is to 27.5, but for ease, to fit in with the 26 and the 29-inch thing we already have, the industry has sort of adopted the name 27.5-inch wheels. Now, when 29 came into the scene, Kurt was quick to sort of realise that they weren't going to be for everyone. There's such a big jump between 26 and 29. They identified that there was actually a size that already existed that could be utilised really well for mountain biking, and pretty much the rest is history because he pursued that to the point that the industry realised it was such a good idea and they've undertaken it completely. So Pacenti stuff, as far as I'm concerned, is great kit. So you're doing no wrong there by having this stuff, and you certainly have not been ripped off. Next up is a question from Dan Scottney about this monstrosity on my wrist. Hi Doddy, I've got a question for you. What make is that watch you wear? Is it custom made? I really like it and wondering where I can get one for myself. It's a really, really old Oakley watch. I don't even know if they still make it. It's probably about 12 years old. I got this a long time ago in a prior life when I was working on Mountain Biking UK magazine. And it's kind of ugly, but I love it. I've always had it. I did used to wear it on my right wrist until I broke my wrist pretty badly. It doesn't actually fit my wrist anymore. So I end up wearing it on this one. And I'm well aware it's not the nicest watch in the world, but it's kind of chunky and just suits me really. I am in the market for a new watch though. I'm thinking of something black, maybe something sporty. Perhaps like a Sunto. Any suggestions out there? Okay, so next up is a pretty in-depth question from Lucas Holkek. And he's asking because he's found a lot of contradicting answers on various mountain bike forums. In your opinion, which internal rim width is ideal for the 2.35 to 2.5 inch tyres today to run basically the common tyre widths, Schwalbe, Contis, Maxxis, Maxxis Wide Trail, etc. Everyone is upgrading to 30 plus millimetres. However, there are some who claim that current tyres are not designed to work well with such a wide width rim. How does the terrain affect the tyre squashiness, all that sort of stuff. I have to upgrade my floppy stock all-mountain rims that have got 23mm internal, and they surprisingly seem to work quite well with my 2.35 Schwalbe Magic Marys. Should I wait until tyre brands catch up or move on? So first up, if we look at your wheel, so 23mm internal diameter, which is pretty narrow for today's sort of wheels, and you're running them with 2.35 Schwalbe Magic Marys. Now, the reason that you say it feels quite good is because that simply is a great tyre and it's got a really good stiff sidewall in virtually all of the different casing options they have. However, that is still going to feel better with a wider internal rim width because you're going to be able to run it at lower pressure and you're not subject to too much sort of carcass wobble. Now, different tyres are going to feel different, and squarer tyres certainly will be a lot squarer and roll slower when you put them on a wider rim. And there is a limit to that. Now, what I've found is the best, like the biggest limit to go for is 30mm internal. Now, there are various ones that go 35, 40, and that's like a substantial size rim. Now, really, anything over 30, I would probably choose to go for a plus size tyre. So that's a 2.8 or a 3-inch tyre. For the 30mm internal width, I think you're fine from 2.35 up to 2.6, and it doesn't really change the shape of the tyre too much. Again, there are going to be some anomalies. A square tyre will get affected by this. But in the other end of the spectrum, a rounder tyre, you can make feel more aggressive and give a better ride feel. Now, I think it depends on your riding style more than the conditions. Some people like to sort of just have a nice easy turn. Some people love to carve an edge in, a bit more like snowboarding. The riders I like to carve are going to want that sort of squarer edge, that more pronounced shoulder, so it does affect what you really want out of the tyre. But something also to mention, the wider rim width you go, the stiffer the wheel's going to be. And stiff is good, but you also got to bear in mind that that stiffness has to go somewhere. So quite often that shock and the stiffness gets transmitted through to the bars. Now I actually prefer to stay on the slimmer side of internal 30mm width for that reason. Too wide is too stiff for me, so it's got the best compromise of how the wheel feels and the tyre size not changing too much. Next up is over to Scott Smith. Hi guys, got a question about the crank arms on my 2017 Giant Trance 4. That's a good bike that, I used to have a Trance. It seems like the crank arms are too low to the ground and they catch on anything, slightest bumps etc. I've had a play around with the suspension but it doesn't seem to help. Do you have any suggestions? Well, I've actually checked out the full spec of this bike and the bottom bracket is low, but it's not crazy low. It's actually praised for the bottom bracket height being low enough that it gives you a good sort of feel on the bike, but not actually being too low that you clip it. So I am wondering if you've got a bit of a problem. Now, the problem could be with the shock. It could be with your tyres. Perhaps your tyre's too soft or it's a bit on the small side on the rear. More than likely, it is going to be a shock problem. So firstly, just make sure you've got the correct amount of sag on there. And when you set your sag, make sure you do this in your full riding kit with any water and other stuff you're likely to carry, because that does affect things significantly. And what you're looking for is 25 to 30% of the available travel as sag when you sit on that bike. Now, if you struggle with this, get a friend to help you, because you can balance up, they can monitor the air pressure and get the O-ring set for you. If it's still not that, then I'm trying to think what other things it could be. I mean, I did do a feature recently where I tell you how I used a lockout on a bike to help keep the bottom bracket higher to avoid clipping pedals. But bearing in mind, the bike was set correctly for me in the first place. It was just to help avoid clipping feet when climbing over things like rocks and roots. That might be helpful for you if your bike is set up and you're still striking your feet. So have a look at that and see if that helps. Next up, Devon Miller, in response to last week when I was looking at the cassettes. So you looked at three different cassettes and how you install them, but you forgot one brand that originated in BMX that's up and coming in the mountain bike world. That is Box One. How will Box One differ from the three in design and install? Okay, so they don't actually differ. The Box One uses the same system as Shimano, and it's very similar to some race and other brands that are already out there. So it uses the lock ring system where the whole cassette slides onto the cassette body and is secured with that lock ring. Very simple system, probably the most original system there has been in mountain biking. It's always been there, and that's how it works. And next up is Army One. Can you guys do a video talking about all the different types of mountain biking, like downhill, cross country, enduro, etc., what they are and what bikes are suitable for them? Kind regards, a curious customer. Yeah, we can, of course we can do that, and we will do that. But you've got to bear in mind that most mountain bikes are good for most things you want to do. You don't need a specific mountain bike to do stuff. So it's not one of those things that you feel like you have to keep buying bikes in order to ride in different ways. So if I just go back to the beginning a minute, so mountain biking actually started in the 70s with a bunch of hippies using converted sort of beach cruiser bikes. They were putting motorcycle brake levers and some tougher bits on them. And they were basically just racing them unofficially down Mount Tamalpais in Marin County, California. And that was really the fundamental start of mountain biking. Bunch of guys having fun just racing each other down a hill. Best man wins sort of thing. And then off the back of that, mountain bike actually took a few leads from road racing, and the XC sort of side of it was born. And the bikes became very lightweight, short geometry with high saddles and long stems, aerodynamic sort of position. But then as riding disciplines grew and sort of changed a bit, bikes kind of evolved to sort of work with that. So you start having downhill bikes which has lower saddles and they had more aggressive angles and suspension and bigger tires and stuff. But really, if you go back to where we are now, you've gone full circle, and the average trail bike is good for most things you're ever likely to do on a mountain bike. And what I mean by that is you can go and ride cross country on it. You can do any sort of trail centers or official trails out there. You could race an enduro on it. You might want to put some tougher tires and things like that, but it'd be good to go. And also you can do a lot of downhill stuff. Now, I don't necessarily mean taking on a World Cup downhill, but the downhills that most people are likely to ride, you're gonna be able to do that on your regular mountain bike. So don't get too focused on the type of mountain bike you need for what you wanna do. Any bike really is gonna be good for you to get out there and learn the basics on any of those disciplines. Next up, question from Axel. Hey guys, is it possible for you to test the Sunrace MX80 cassette? Well, firstly, no, we don't really do product reviews, but I have ridden that before, so I'm very familiar with it. I don't know if it fits to my bike. I've got a Canyon Strive AL7 Race from 2015. What do you think about a cassette? Is it worth buying it, or should I stick to SRAM? Well, I don't know the spec of your bike exactly. Basically, if your bike has got a Shimano cassette on there, the Sunrace will fit because it uses the same fitting system. So the Sunrace cassette has got an 11 to 50 range. It's massive. It's a really, really nice bit of kit, and it's a great alternative to SRAM and Shimano. But like I said, if you've already got Shimano on there, it would work and it'd be a good hop up. If you've got SRAM on there, I'd be more inclined to stick to SRAM or even look at things like E13 because you don't have to change the driver body. If you want to fit the Sunrace one, basically you're going to have to upgrade your hub to fit the driver body that fits the SRAM cassette on, as well as the price of getting a SRAM cassette. So just think about the amount of money you want to spend in the long term there. Sunrace is the easy option if you've already got a Shimano on there. If not, stick with SRAM, I think. Okay, next up from Rick George. Hey guys, as with most people, I'm trying to get the biggest bang for my buck when upgrading my bike. Assuming the used components are in good condition, is it better to buy a 3 to 5 year old XT, XTR drivetrain or buy a new deal or SLX? Are 3 to 5 year old XT, XTR components still better than the latest offerings? Thanks a lot. Personally, I don't have any issue buying secondhand stuff. I bought a lot of camera stuff secondhand, and I buy secondhand bike stuff here and there. But I do tend to buy stuff that can be fixed and maintained easily. And things like that include things like a chain set, for example. So if the chain rings are worn out, you can replace those chain rings. That's no issue. If the bottom bracket's worn out, it's a future replaceable part. The same if you buy a set of suspension forks or a shock off someone, each individual part is replaceable. So if there are any problems with it in the future, you can get those things repaired. But with stuff like a transmission, you've got to bear in mind how much abuse that gets on a bike, mainly because of the torque that goes through it and also the conditions that mountain bikers ride in. Now, things like a rear mech, it may look good, a secondhand one, and it may be a great price, but you're never going to know how baggy it is, if it's lost its spring, or even if it's bent. I mean, it's very much down to the good faith of the person that's selling it and advertising it to be sold. So personally, I would actually go for a brand new deal or SLX set rather than buying a secondhand XT or XTR set, because you really don't know what you're going to get with the secondhand stuff. Again, don't let it put you off buying other secondhand components. Like I said, wheels, forks, there's plenty of things you can buy, you can upgrade. But if you do buy a secondhand rear derailleur and it is bent or it's wobbly and that, there's not really much you can do about it. So you could replace the jockey wheels on it and that's about it. You might just be stuck with something that's already worn out. Next up is a question from Jasper in relation to the clips and flats video I did recently, kind of like how to pick a pedal for your bike. One question, why is concave important? Almost every brand brings this up, but I don't really understand the benefit of this. I've always set my flats up well and had no problems. Can you shed some light? Okay, so basically a concave pedal enables your foot to sit into the pedal that bit more, so you've got a bit more feel, a bit more control than you have with a flat pedal, as in completely flat surface. Now, I think the easiest analogy to talk about this is with skateboards. So if you've ever skated on a completely flat skateboard, you'll know it's a lot harder to ollie and control the board than it is with a concave skateboard, where you have a better feel and purchase on that. That is the feeling we're talking about with concave pedals. And if a pedal doesn't actually have that, you can still achieve this by using shorter pins on the middle and bigger pins on the outside, just to help your foot sit into that. It's basically all about feel. But of course, don't let this sort of dictate to you what you should have. It is a personal preference thing. Most riders that run flat pedals do prefer a concave feel, but that's not to say that you have to. Cool, now this is a bit of a different question from Bike Stuff, and this is directly to me. Doddy, what type of rider are you? Are you a cross-country racer, an enduro rider, or a downhill rider? To be honest, I just class myself as a mountain biker, because when I started in sort of the late 80s, early 90s, there wasn't really any disciplines, there was just mountain biking. And if you raced, it was cross-country racing. But it wasn't called cross-country back then, it was just racing, because that's what it was. As the sport developed, other things came into it, street riding, trials, downhill, slalom. And I kind of sort of chose to do bits and pieces of all of those. And to be honest, I love all forms of mountain biking. I'm quite happy going out for, you know, a cross-country, uphill, downhill type of ride, as I am going to local woods, pushing up and doing some downhill runs. Or equally, going for a bit of an urban ride with Blake and, you know, hitting some stuff and a bit of jibbing. Literally, I love all of it. Although I've got to say, I'm not massively keen on racing these days. I am competitive and I do like racing. Probably just to the fact that I need to spend a lot more time on a bike to do that. And when it comes to the weekend, I'm quite happy to just ride, to be honest. Cool, next up is a techie question from Cameron Prentice. Hey guys, is there a way to adjust the B screw on Eagle without the adjustment tool that measures it for you? Well, yeah, there is. Let me just explain to people what that is first. So the B tension adjusts the height of the upper guide wheel on your rear mech from the biggest sprocket of the cassette. Now, it's especially important on 11 and 12 speed to get that gap right, because otherwise you're never going to be able to change gear well, and that top guide wheel will actually foul on the top of the cassette there. So it will never work correctly unless you get it right. Now, SRAM have developed this little plastic clipping tool just to aid the setup of that, and it's a visual reference basically. And yeah, it makes it a lot easier, but you don't need it. So what you're looking for is a 15mm gap between the upper wheel. So you want 15mm of daylight between the upper wheel and the top of your, the biggest wheel of your cassette there. But it's important, you need that measurement to be done when the bike is sagged, so when you're sat on that bike. So you don't need to have the tool for this, but you will need a friend to help you. So the easiest thing to do is to either sit on the bike and balance and get your friend to make the adjustment for you to allow the 15mm when you're on it. Or alternatively, you can let the air pressure down on the shock and hold your bike at that point, and either use a toe strap or something to compress the back end for you, then set it, or even just get someone to hold it and do it yourself so you can see where it is. So you don't need the tool. It does make it easier, but just look for that 15mm gap, and don't forget to do it when the bike is sagged. Okay, maintenance related question from Benjamin Billingsley here. After seeing your teardown of the headset a few days ago, I'm curious if there's other maintenance you should be done at certain intervals. I'd love to see a list of things to check every ride, or perhaps time-based every 3 hours, 10 hours, etc. And there may be maintenance I should be doing in the off-season. Checking brake pivots, how often to check chain tension, brake fluid. I know there are loads of variables such as riding conditions, etc. Be good to have a starting point, especially for the average rider. Do you know what? That's a really good point. We do talk about regular maintenance, and it is very hard because of those variables to tell you exactly when to do it. So if you start with a chain, so if you have a little chain checker tool, it's a really good idea to have one of these, especially if you ride a lot or if you ride in really demanding conditions. So when I say demanding, I mean muddy or dry and gritty. So anything that can give premature wear to the chain. The more often you check your chain, the least likely you are to have to replace it at the same time as the cassette and the chain rings. You'll at least be able to get two chains to one cassette if you monitor that use. Of course, it does vary on the amount that you do ride. With forks and shocks, generally most manufacturers will recommend a 50 or 100 hour intervals for servicing. So 50 hours for a shock is a basic air can service. That means removing the air can, re-greasing the seals, putting a bit of lubricant in there, putting it back together again. And for fork, that's a lower leg service. So again, it's a fairly simple procedure that you can follow at home if you're comfortable, and just requires sometimes changing the seals, but usually just inspecting them, greasing them, and putting some fresh lubricant inside. At the 100 hours, that's a full damper overhaul and service. That's the same for forks and shocks. Again, this does vary. You know, this is a typical sort of usage that a manufacturer will recommend. You might find that with your riding, it might be 200 hours you need to do this. But it's just a guideline just to make sure that everyone's covered. Now with brakes, it does vary because some brakes are mineral fluid, which need slightly less maintenance on them, and some brakes are dot fluid. So the dot fluid brakes, SRAM for example, recommend annually you should replace the fluid and give your brakes a full overhaul. Now again, brakes are something that we all use constantly, so I tend to find that they need regular maintenance. You know, every few months they might need, one of them might need a bleed, or you might have split a hose in a crash, things like that. It's down to paying attention to how much you ride. But I do love your idea about having some regular charts and stuff with some recommendations on. So I am going to work on something like this for all of you guys. So hopefully today's Ask GMBN Tech has been helpful for you guys. Please continue to keep those questions coming in on the Facebook page, even via Instagram as well. Use the email link on the screen and add them in the comments below. Of course, there's so many of them, we can't always get them all on, but we always try and answer them as best as we can. If you want to find out a couple more really cool videos to get you going, here's 5 riders to watch for 2018 up the top here. And if you want to see the pedals video where I recommend how you choose a set of pedals that suit your sort of riding, click down here. As always, click on the globe to subscribe, and if the video was good for you and you like it, give us a thumbs up.